Cause you're in and out the prison keys. My soul was made to be free. I know you by a thousand names, and you deserve every single one. You've given me a million ways to be amazed at what you've done, and I am lost in wonder at all you do. I know you by a thousand names, and I'll sing on back. I'll sing on back.
What do you think? This gonna cause for a little rhythm. Don't get scared. Here we go. Here we go. If you're that good, put that foot in there too. Here we go.
I'm praising the valley.
Oh!
cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I said I praise cause you're sovereign. Praise cause you reign. Praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise cause you're faithful. Praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you.
God is good. Okay, for announcements, guess who we got coming up? I want to introduce to you Cole, Brother Cole.
Good morning, Simi Community Church. How are you guys doing?
Great, great.
Good, good. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Cole. I'm the youth intern here at Simi Community Church. So we just have a couple of announcements for today. Our first one is, if you're brand new here, welcome. We love to have you. If you wouldn't mind filling out that Connect card in the seat back in front of you, that would be greatly appreciated so you guys can get updated on what's going on here at Simi Community. And next one, we have our, if you sign up for our Saturday email, we send out the emails the day before so you guys get notified early about what's going on here at Simi Community Church. And then next one. Tonight, we have our hymn, sing, and praise at 6:30, so if you guys like hymn music or have grown up with it, we have a worship service for that. That's starting tonight here, and I think that is it. So why don't we stand up and greet one another as we before we go into more worship.
Alright, sweet. So we're going to jump back into worship with this song that we did last week. If you remember it, please sing along with us. All my words fall short, and I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. Oh, so I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a
times, and we have to remember all we got is one way out. It may seem like you had other options, but there's only one way, and we pray to that same God every time, especially in times like this. I'm calling on the God of Jacob. Love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the oceans. I need you now to do the same for me. Oh God,
God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh Rock, oh Rock of Ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness.
I'm calling on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know if you are things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath,
but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh Rock of Ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness.
Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you. Children, then you hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are the same God. You are the same God. Did you move in power then? God, move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You are a healer then. You are a healer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You are a savior then. You are a savior now. You are the same God. You are the same God. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. And oh Rock, oh Rock of Ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now.
And oh,
and oh Rock of Ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness.
Come and fill me up.
Camp. That was the Forest Home for our elementary kids, and Hume Lake for our middle school and high schoolers. Did you guys have a great time? Yeah, did you have a great time? Yeah, all right. We're going to hear a little bit from the Forest Home kids. A few of those kids want to come up and speak, and they're going to answer a few questions. Come on up, come on up.
Yep, perfect.
You got your coffee there, Roman? Okay, excellent. You need that. You're not peppy enough. Go ahead, over there.
Can you make it up? He's got this. We had the joy of taking a group of kids to Forest Home, which was the first part of that video. You can see how much fun we had. And I actually, as I'm talking, I want to call up all the counselors too. George, Nick, Kim, Laura, if you guys want to come on up and stand maybe behind. They were amazing. But to kind of share some of the things that we did, I called up a few of the kids to see if they can tell us some of their memories. So, Roman, why don't we start with you? Can you tell me your best memory of Forest Home?
Swimming in the lake.
Very fun. Beautiful lake. It's not a lake that you think it is. It's a very beautiful lake. Andrew, would you like to share what you feel like the Lord was teaching you at Forest Home?
God is always with us.
Samantha, do you have a favorite memory?
When we were doing the songs and we did the benediction, we put our arms around each other like this.
And Zoe, what do you feel like the Lord was teaching you at Forest Home?
That He made this world and He wants us to live in it and have fun.
All right. Ooh, as I fall off. Close. We had a blast. Such a great group of kids and also a great group of counselors. I can't even tell you. I am so, so thankful. We have George, Nick, Laura, and then Kim, who's not here today. But they, I'm telling you, they took the week off of work, set aside their other responsibilities at home, and joined us for the whole week. And not just joined us, but they participated. They were part of it, loving the kids, sharing Jesus with them. And I am so, so grateful. What a great team. Thank you.
Well, if you're going to be on the Hume Lake panel, come on up right now. Roman, don't forget your coffee. Come on up, Hume Lake. You got it special. All right, take a seat up there, ladies, young men. And as well, if you were a Hume Lake counselor, come on up. Stand behind these lovely youth. Come on up, come on up. We'll get you. Stand back there. All right, so same couple questions for you guys. Can you, anyone can answer. What was your favorite part of camp? Leanne has the mic if you want to pass that over to you. Someone want to answer. What was your favorite part of camp? Anybody? Just raise your hand and take the mic.
My favorite part of camp was probably the worship, because the worship up there is just so impactful, and like the worship team, they just did a great job with it, and it was like, I've never worshiped like that before.
Nice. Anyone else? What was your favorite part?
Oh, my favorite part? Oh, okay, that's kind of hard.
Yeah.
There's a lot, like, the week that was this year was a lot different than other years, because I had a little group last year, and then this previous year, it's kind of different. But my favorite part was this group of five that I had. We just bonded throughout the whole week, and it was just amazing and all that.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Thank you. What about one of the ladies? What was your favorite, most memorable part of camp?
Definitely the worship. It was amazing. But like chapel, like, but when I went to Hume Lake before, I was excited for like free time or recreation or something. But this year, like, I was like excited to go to chapel. I wanted to go. Like, I was so happy we got to go two times a day and go to worship and listen to the speaker and everything and be with my friends. And it was really fun.
Nice. So the ladies up here, I know that you guys had a really, really nice luxury cabin. Is this correct? No, like for real, these were brand new cabins that I heard were only built like 2 months ago. Each bunk had its own USB port, right? Was it good? I'm serious, right?
Yeah, actually yeah. It was great. I'm going to brag about it real quick. Because the guys only had a little tin box.
They did.
And they were like, what do you mean you get a full cabin? And we had like showers and a bathroom and all these nice beds. And they were like, what are you talking about? I have to get up at 2 a.m. to go walk and take a shower.
This is true.
So it was great, actually.
Christian, you want to tell us about the cabin for you? Yeah. Oh, wait, John wants to say something.
I was on a mattress on the floor.
He was on the mattress on the floor. No joke, the ladies' cabin was probably the size of the entire stage, right? They had 2 bathroom showers and everything, right? How big was your guys' cabin?
It was about the size of a shed.
I think this. It was as big as the platform they're on right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
John literally was on the floor.
We only had 2 bunk beds per room, so only 4 beds. It was extremely small and cramped with all the suitcases in there. No bathrooms. We had to walk either like up the hill or down the hill to get to one.
In the snow.
But
in the heat, it was
very
hot.
We had to go like a little far.
Very hot.
Not a little far, but like.
Oh.
But to shower, the only time I got a shower and was able to get in right away, I got up at 5:30 in the morning. Every other time, it was crowded, and I had to wait at least like 10 minutes. Had to get up early. Wish I could have got what they had. 2 showers. Even the middle schoolers got a better cabin than us.
They did. This is true. The middle school boys, too.
Yes, the middle school. Every person got a better cabin than us.
Well, but, Christian, aside from that experience, would you say, I want to go again to camp, I want to go to Hume, I want to bring friends. Is it worth it for your parents and all your parents to spend all that money, because it's a lot of money, it's a lot, is it worth it to go to camp?
It was definitely worth it. I mean, the cabins weren't the best, but everything else was really good, except for the food. But
that was okay.
Not really.
That was all right.
Lost 7 pounds, actually. So,
Caitlin, I'm going to ask you a question. This is my niece, Caitlin, by the way, one of my nieces. Caitlin, what was something that you felt that the Lord was teaching you that week? And do you feel it's changed you since you've been back?
I definitely learned that I should like be spending more time in God's word and working on my relationship with him. And something that the pastor said that really stuck out to me was we should rather have a tarnished reputation than a tarnished relationship with God. And so like, even though I may be scared to share my faith, it shouldn't matter what other people think of me. It should matter more what God thinks of me.
Thank you. Yep. And would anyone else like to share about their... what you felt God was teaching you, or how life has been since you've been back? How has camp changed you?
I learned a lot this week, because when you're at Hume and you're surrounded by other Christians and a lot of accountability, everything, you really realize like what your struggle is with your faith, because you're surrounded by everyone who has similar problems or different ones, but it's all like through Christianity. And something the pastor said was, every day, you're either growing closer to God or growing farther away. I thought that was really interesting, because it's like every day, really? Like every day you're making a step forward or backwards. It's always moving. And I learned to be like more vulnerable with worship and just like really growing closer to him. It's really great. It's super easy to do that up there. So.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate you guys being up here. I know you get a little bit nervous being on stage, but thank you so much for sharing about Hume Lake. Let's hear it for these high schoolers. I also want to take a moment real quick. You guys can make your way down so we can see these. Thank you very much. These lovely people back here. Take a chair and put it back down there for me, please, if you don't mind. These are our counselors, 4 of the 6 counselors that went. You guys can step up real quick. I just want to thank you. A couple of the counselors couldn't join us today. There you are. Oh, my goodness. He appeared like out of nowhere. Freaked me out, man. All right. You can't jump up on me like that. I'll take you down. All right.
I am here.
He's here. All right. Well, we got Brian was our middle school boys counselor. So thank you very much, Brian. He's been to camp a zillion times. as a camper and now a counselor. My other niece over there, that's Alyssa. Alyssa was the middle school girls counselor. Thank you, Alyssa. You did a great job. You connected so well with those young ladies, and I know they had a lot of fun with you. And over here, you guys know who this is. This is Layla. Layla Mulford. Layla was one of our high school girl counselors. And Layla, I just want to say, every time I walked past you, I'd ask you, like, how are you doing? You okay? You need anything? And she'd always just be like, I'm doing great. I'm doing great. All good. And she was. I didn't have to worry about anything. You had everything taken care of, and you just, again, bonded with those girls really, really well. So I thank you so much. We have Andrea, couldn't be here today. She was a last-minute join to us. I'm so grateful to have her because up until like a week or so, a few days before Hume, we didn't have enough girl counselors. And so she was somebody from a previous church to join. So I thank her. She couldn't join us today. And then we got John and Johnny. These guys are the rock stars. They were our high school boys counselors. And these guys, okay, so we're all about the same age, right? We're middle-aged dudes, but these guys got in there, and you saw that video. John was throwing the ball. These guys, if they could have done the bike flip off the ramp, they would have, but they weren't allowed to because, you know, we got injuries and stuff like that. But these, no joke, these guys got in there and did every bit of game and activity they possibly could, so I thank you so much. I really, really appreciate you being there. If you guys weren't there, I couldn't have done any of this, so thank you so much. I also want to take a moment to thank Leanne, my wife. She went to Hume. That's all right, thank you. She went to Hume with us as well, and she was in a unique position to really help the ladies out, the counselors, and really address areas for the young ladies that were, you know, just specific to them, and without her, I don't know what to do here. So she was an angel. Thank you so much, Leanne, for being there. Let's hear it for our counselors. All right, you guys can make your way down. I want to go ahead and invite up our worship team one more time and our choir one more time. We have a very special song for you, and the youth are going to lead that so they can make their way on stage.
Please stand.
Even the storm and the pain I smell in said your grace is always enough. You said your heart never forget or forsake me. You said I'm saved, you call me yours. You said my future's full of your hope. You've never failed, so I know that you'll never fail me. You said your love would never give up. You said your grace is always enough. You said your heart would never forget or forsake me. You said I'm saved, you call me yours. You said my future's full of your hope. You've never failed, so I know that you'll never fail.
I was wondering if we're going to hear that big again that we had earlier. All right, good morning, good morning. Well, I want to say thank you again to this amazing worship team that we had today. Let's hear it for them. Do you know that, we had some first-time musicians up there. We had Cole on the guitar, first time on the guitar up there. We had my son Nathan on the keyboards, Jared on the bass. Those are all their first time up on stage for a lot of these youth musicians. We had our amazing kids, youth, and youth choir, and all of the lovely ladies that were up here singing. They are part of our youth band and youth worship singers on Wednesday night. So again, thank you so much to these amazing, amazing students, as well as all the other worship leaders that were here today and taking part. Wasn't it wonderful that we can have our youth be involved in today's service so that you can get to see who they are and who is the future of our church, our community, our country, our world. Great to hear their testimonies, what they learned at Hume, how they've been growing, and what God is doing in their life. And so if you have had children, if you have children, perhaps they may be still little, or if you can think back when your child was a youngster, there's a commonality between a lot of children, and that is that they ask questions, a whole lot of questions, right? My kids did it. My youngest one still does it. Daddy, what is that? Why is that? How is that? How come? Why? This, that, whatever, right? They ask a lot of questions because questions and getting the answers is how they learn about life, how they learn about the world, how they learn about their surroundings, how they learn about themselves. And so while at Hume Lake, and even at Forest Home, the youth and the children, instead of being the ones asking all the questions, they were asked certain questions, especially at Hume Lake. And that's going to be the focus of today. They were asked about their life, their world, and their faith. So if you have your Bibles today, I'd like you to open up to the book of Matthew. First book, New Testament, Matthew, if you have it. I'll give you a second there. I'm going to give you the context. This is Matthew 16, Matthew chapter 16. Okay, this is where we were at Hume Lake. So at Hume Lake, the middle school and high schoolers were learning all about Matthew, specifically this section, chapter 16. And so the background leading up to this section of Scripture, at this point, Jesus had performed a lot of miracles. Right, he had turned water into wine. He had healed many people. He'd given voice to the mute, sight to the blind. He had regrown a man's withered hand. He miraculously fed 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Then he did that same exact miracle again for 4,000 people. And he even raised a dead girl back to life. A dead girl back to life. Okay, so that's where we're at chapter 16 of Matthew. And as we open up that section, it's strange, it's frustrating, but you're going to see that the Pharisees and the Sadducees, these are the religious leaders of the time, they say to Jesus, hey, Jesus, we're going to need some proof that you are who you say you are. Can you show us some signs and some wonders? I don't know about you, but he did a whole bunch of things already. He raised a dead child back to life. How much more proof do they need? What do they want him to do? They had hardened and stubborn hearts. They had hardened and stubborn hearts. They had everything they needed for salvation, everything they needed to believe that Jesus was the Messiah, yet they said, no, we're going to need some more proof. So let's read Matthew 16. We're going to go over verses 13 through 17. And it says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And they replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. And Jesus said, well, what about you? He asked, who do you say I am? And Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. So let's take a closer look at this passage here, okay? So you see this term, Jesus says, Son of Man. He asked them, who do people say the Son of Man is? And you might be wondering, well, what does that mean? So I'll give you this background. The Son of Man is one of the favorite titles that Jesus used most often to describe himself. Okay, so Son of Man, number one, is a reflection of Jesus' humanity, meaning that he is 100% man or a human. This title was often used by God in the Old Testament of the prophet Ezekiel. And it's simply meaning you are a real person. You're a human being. You're a man, right? But, however, Son of Man is also a reflection of Jesus' divinity. He is 100% God. Jesus is not 50% man and 50% God. He's 100% God and 100% man. He's both. Mark 2:28, it says, the Son of Man is the Lord of the Sabbath. So we see that description of divinity. He's God. He's ruler. In Matthew 26:64, we see that Jesus is the second person of the Trinity. It reads, from now on you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One coming on the clouds in heaven, from heaven. So Jesus is titled Son of Man, his humanity and his divinity. So in 13, we see that Jesus and his disciples are in a region called Caesarea Philippi. Now, this was an important city about 25 miles north of the Sea of Galilee. I believe I have a map up there of that. And I got my pointer here because I learned from Tony. And there it is. All right. So you got the Sea of Galilee right here. Caesarea Philippi is right there. Okay, Galilee, Sea of Galilee. This is the region, and this is all of Israel right there. That kind of looks like New Jersey. Maybe it is. I don't know. All right. So now you know where we're at. And in this region, Caesarea Philippi, they worshipped many, many deities, many gods. They worshipped this one god called Baal. You might have heard of Baal. He's common. He comes up a lot in the Old Testament. So they worshipped this god Baal. And it's interesting, in Canaanite mythology, Baal is considered like their chief god, their highest god, kind of like a Zeus in Greek mythology, okay? But this is Baal. And, you know, the Israelites, they have Yahweh. You heard us sing a song last year about Yahweh, right? So Baal, in a sense, is like this anti-Yahweh for those who, not the Israelites, but for the Canaanites, those in this region, kind of like an anti-god type figure. And in the area, they also worship the Greek god Pan. And Pan is the god of nature. He's a shepherd type of god. And he's often depicted as this goat-man hybrid thing. Now, if you look at that picture and you were to say, man, who does that kind of look like? What do you guys think? Male, yeah? What do you guys kind of think that thing looks like? I think it kind of looks a little bit like these depictions of Satan, right? Kind of like the goat feet thing, right? Kind of looks like that. I'm not saying that Satan looks like this, right? I'm not saying that. However, I find it very interesting that you have this Greek god Pan and all these, you know, drawings when we see cartoons of Satan. It's kind of a similar type of way, right? So Pan is the shepherd god, goat man, and he's kind of this anti-Jesus or anti-shepherd, right? Anti-Christ type of figure. And there they also worshipped the emperor, Caesar. And so they looked to their political leaders to save them. And so here in this region, they have an anti-God type deity, an anti-Christ type deity, and political idolatry. Is this not similar to where we're at today? To where we are at right now, to the very world that our youth are living in, are growing up in, are going to have to face in the future. We live in a society that is anti-God. Our schools and our universities teach our children that there is no one true God, there is no Yahweh, or they teach them that you can be sort of like a God to yourself, because whatever you say is word, right? If it's true for you, then it's true. If you feel it, then it is. You can be a God to yourself. We also live in a world that is anti-Jesus, anti-Christ. To be a follower of Christ is to be rejected and ridiculed as narrow-minded and intolerant. Now, I don't know about you, but did anybody watch the opening ceremony of the Olympics? Was that not one of the most this repulsive mockery of Christ, of Jesus, of our faith, right? You had a mockery of the Last Supper up there. And I didn't watch it, but I saw clips of it, and it is repulsive. This is the climate in which our youth are living in, which we are living in right now. It's an anti-Christ type of society. And soon, perhaps, we may even have the actual Antichrist. We live in a society that also looks to our political leaders, to a political party or a person to save us. No matter which side you are on, we are to honor and to respect our leaders. Yes, absolutely. That's what the word says. But they're not our saviors, right? They're not our saviors. And we have too many Christians who place their politics over their faith. Politics is an important part of our life and our society, and we should vote. Please do so, right? Be a good citizen. We have a biblical citizenship class that teaches us about our country. I'm proud of our country. I serve our country. We vote. But politics will not save us, and it can become idolatrous to us. So let's continue on verse 14. Jesus asked the disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" There we see that title again. And they replied in verse 14, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the other prophets." And I love now this teaching strategy of Jesus. Jesus is always asking questions. He always asks questions, right? But unlike the little child that we talked about in the beginning, who's asking questions so that they can learn, Jesus asks us questions so that we can learn. He wants us to think. He wants us to ponder in our heart and our mind the question that he's asking us so that we can formulate a right answer. And the question that he asks is, well, who do other people say that I am? Young people of today are being taught so many false things about who Jesus is and who Jesus is not. We have lots of world religions out there who say very, very contrary things about Jesus. Let's take a look at a few of them. Major world religions here. In Islam, Muslims say that Jesus was indeed, yes, born of a virgin and that he's holy. However, they do not believe that Jesus is the Son of God. They actually very, very violently deny that Jesus is the Son of God. And they say he's just a prophet. And his sacrificial death on the cross has no power to save us. In Judaism, non-believing Jews say that Jesus is not the Messiah, that he was a blasphemer, that his miracles were the work of Satan, and that while he, yes, he did die on the cross, he deserved it because of blasphemy. And they deny the resurrection. Hindus believe that Jesus is a holy man, and they worship him as one of many gods in their pantheism. But he is not the way, the truth, and the life. Rather, he's just an example of what humanity, what we can achieve. The divine self-revelation or realization, what we might call the Christ consciousness, that you can become a God yourself. Very similar to what we see in the New Age type movement that is prevalent in our society. And Buddhists, like Hindu, believe that Jesus was a good teacher and a holy man, except opposite to the Hindus who say that Jesus is a God, one of many gods, Buddhists deny Jesus' divinity altogether, and they believe that he was just a human, right? We talked about 100% man, 100% God, okay? So those are some of the major world religions. What about the cults? We got the Mormons right over the other side of our wall there. Well, they say that, yeah, we believe in Jesus, but their Jesus is not the Jesus of the Bible. Their Jesus is the spirit child of the Heavenly Father and the Heavenly Mother and the brother of Lucifer or Satan, and Jesus is the God of earth. And they believe that when you die, you and your spouse and your gazillion children that you have will end up being a god of your own planet. That's what they believe. Now, I don't know about you. I have a hard enough time managing my own household. I have no desire to be a god of my own planet. Thank you very much. Finally, Jehovah's Witnesses deny the Trinity. They believe that Jesus was a created being. And they infamously changed John 1:1 to say that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was a God. Note that little change there. One letter changes everything. They believe that Jesus is not God Almighty. They think he's Michael the Archangel. And so his power, his death on the cross has no power to remove our sins. You know, I was at the Simi Library the other day. I always like to go to the library. If you've been to the Simi Library, you know that the Jehovah's Witnesses and the Mormons like to park themselves outside the library, right? Have you seen them? You've seen them. One time I got this lengthy discussion with a couple Mormons, and my boys were like, Dad, let's go, and get our books out. And I got to tell them one more thing, right? So it was a lengthy discussion. One day, I walked up to the library with the boys, and there was the Jehovah's Witnesses. They had their booth and their pamphlets, right? And I don't have time for this. I walked right past them. As I'm getting up to the library, here comes two young men riding bikes. The Mormons. And I think to myself, this is the moment I've been waiting for. This is it. I'm going to go ahead. I got the Jehovah's Witnesses right here and the Mormons right there. And they're going to come together. And you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to grab a bag of popcorn and a lounge chair. And I'm just going to sit there and watch these two guys for once and see what they say. And then come in and sweep up after. Right? That was an interesting time. But you see that the question of Jesus, of who he is and who he is not, do you see how important that is? Jesus is everything. He is the foundation of our faith. 1 Corinthians 15:14. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. If Jesus is not who he says he is in his word, then all of this is pointless. Then me standing here is pointless, it's useless, it's meaningless, and you sitting in those chairs is a waste of your time. You sending your youth, your children to camp is a waste of your money. All of it's useless if Jesus is not who he says he is in his word. So back to Matthew 16. So the disciples tell Jesus who others say that he is, right? We already went through that. But notice what Jesus doesn't do. Jesus doesn't correct the false claim. He doesn't say, well, yeah, I'm not John the Baptist, and here's a list of reasons why, and I'm not one of the other prophets, and here's a list of reasons why. Now, don't get me wrong. Having a rebuttal, having an explanation of biblical truth is necessary at times. A presentation of the facts of the word is necessary at times. I love apologetics. Apologetics is the defense of the gospel. It's the presentation of facts of the word to support what we believe. So there's a time and place for that. But notice that Jesus just gets to the heart of the matter. Because facts without faith is useless. Facts without faith is useless. Satan knows the Bible, every sentence, every word better than we do, but it's useless to him. He doesn't believe, right? If what we believe doesn't change how we live, then again, it's meaningless. And so Jesus goes straight to the heart of the matter, and he says in verse 15, but what about you? Right? Doesn't address any of them. It doesn't matter what they say right now. We're going to talk about you. What do you, or who do you say that I am? And this is the question that was asked to our youth at Hume Lake. Who do you say that I am? Not who do your parents say that I am? Not what did your youth pastor teach about me? Not what Pastor Tony said? Right? Not what our church teaches you. Who do you say that I am? See, because I can't save you. Pastor Tony can't save you. Your church can't save you. Your parents' heritage and their faith, where they brought you up, can't save you. Only Jesus can save you. And ultimately, when we stand before God, that's all that will matter. The answer to the question. What is your answer to that question? Who do you say I am? And Simon Peter, 16:17, verses 16 and 17, he answers. He says, you are the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed one. You're the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And that's the amazing part. Note that in my own strength, in my own power, in my own mind, in my own will, my own knowledge, I can't accept Jesus unless the Father draws me and us to him. There's nothing in me that would allow me to even choose Christ unless the Father chooses me first. That's real love. That's real love. That the Father, through the Holy Spirit, removes the blinders off my eyes, off my heart, and allows me to say yes to the redemptive work of Christ Jesus, the Son of the living God. It was God that gives you and I that ability to say that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And I hope that that brings you to a place of, one, of humility, right? That he would choose you, that he would look out in the vast scope of humanity and says, I pick you, and I pick you. I hope that would bring you to a place of humanity as well as gratitude and as well as joy. And again, this is the question that our youth was asked. Who is Jesus? Who do you say that I am? And I had the joy and the privilege to witness many of our youth, some for the first time, stand up, raise their hand, say, yes, I put my faith in Jesus. Or yes, I want to recommit my life to Jesus. I also had the joy of watching someone say, yes, I want to say yes to Jesus for the very first time. So please go ahead and take a look at this video.
This is an exciting moment for Cindy, who's come to us all the way to Hume Lake to be a part of Simi Community Church's trip to Hume Lake 2024. Well, what's the date today? July 12th, 2024. Cindy has traveled all the way, as you all know, from Argentina, all the way to the amazing country of Argentina. And I spoke to her family today, and they were very, very excited. And they said, absolutely, she can make this decision here with you all, her friends that she's made, all the way here in California, Hume Lake, again, 2024. So they are very excited for you. I spoke to them, and they are very, very, very excited for you. So Cindy, last night you made the decision that you want to follow Jesus. Is that correct? Yeah. What made you decide to do that? Anything specific? Anything yesterday that spoke to you? She says she wants to follow Jesus, right? Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's raining. To rain.
All right. Well, Cindy, in front of all your new friends here, and in front of all these people here at beautiful Hume Lake, I'm going to ask you two questions, okay? Number one, Cindy, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died for you, that he rose to life to forever wash away your sins? Do you believe that? She said yes. And Cindy, have you committed to saying, I want to walk in the ways of Jesus? I want to follow him all my life. I want to make him the Lord of my life. Is that what you want? And she says yes. All right. Okay. So again, Cindy, go ahead and plug your nose. All right, Cindy, in front of all your friends here, but especially in front of God the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, I baptize you now in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm glad you got to witness that. It was a good time. There's a few people who are also going to be baptized today. And so if you are one of those three young men, you may go ahead and make your way, start getting prepared for that. Well, as you saw on that video, that young lady, her name is Cindy. And Cindy's not a regular attender of our youth group. She's not here today at church. She's not even a part of our church, yet she came to Hume Lake with Simi Community Youth. And she came to Hume Lake all the way from, as you saw, Argentina. She had her Argentina soccer jersey on there, or should I say football jersey. Cindy is a niece of a friend of mine, and her aunt and uncle. Are they here today? I think they said they were. There we go, right there, back there. That's Linda. Thank you, yeah. Cindy came to us, like I said, all the way from Argentina. And she chose to be baptized there at Hume Lake, to put her faith in Jesus Christ. And now I was certain to call her family first and say, hey, is this okay with you? I know as a parent, I would want to be there and watch in person my child's baptism, but is this okay with you? This is what she wants to do. And her parents sent this message back, and they said, yes, you know, of course we would want to be there to see this, but this is her decision. This is her answer to the question of who do you say that Jesus is? And so they said, yes, if she chooses to be baptized there at Hume Lake with her new friends from Simi Community, then that is her choice, and we bless that decision. And I got this message from her aunt and uncle, from her parents. They texted, they said, we've received back a better, upgraded, and improved daughter. And they are so very grateful and blessed by Simi Community Church and the work that has been done here. And so, Simi Community, I tell you, you have a family of believers all the way in Argentina now. Okay, you have a family over there. Yes. I believe that Cindy and her family might be watching live right now. They get a yes. They're probably watching live right now. And so, Cindy, I want to say to you, it was a joy to have you with us at Hume Lake. It was a joy for you to be there and spend that week with us. I know all the young ladies there and the whole group there were just so happy to have you with us. We would absolutely love for you to join us again sometime. Maybe you and your family could come and visit us, right, ladies? You'd probably want her to come back. Or maybe, I don't know, let's do a mission trip over there someday. Maybe we can do that, whatever the Lord wills, right? I also happen to know that Cindy's 15th birthday is, when is it? Was that? October, okay. It's going to be in a couple months, though, right? So she's going to be 15 pretty soon, and we're going to do a little special something for Cindy. We'll send that video over to her. So happy birthday to you, and especially happy new life in Jesus Christ. All right, as I said, the celebration doesn't end there. We have a few more baptisms. So as we're going to prepare for those baptisms, I'd like to take it now to invite our worship team back up. Let's have our worship band and the lead singers up here. Friends, I tell you that there is no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. The name of Jesus Christ. And what a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Amen.
Hidden glory in creation. Now today.
Yes.
Up first, we have Jack. And Jack was at Hume Lake with us. Did you have a great time?
Yes.
You got your camp shirt on there? Mm-hmm. Yeah. What was your favorite part of camp?
My favorite part was kayaking.
Kayaking. All right, kayaking in the lake. Well, Jack, I know that you said over there at Hume Lake, I want to get baptized, and I don't want to wait and do it back here with my family and my friends because you wanted them to see you. Where's your family? Step over here so they can see you. Where's Jack's family? There they are, right there. There they are. All right. I'm very proud of you. Okay. So, Jack, I have two questions for you. Okay. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died and rose for the forgiveness of your sins?
Yes.
Excellent. Have you committed to following him, to walking in his ways the rest of your life? All right, Jack, forward with me right here. I want you to plug your nose. Okay, Jack, based on your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Hey, Jack, congratulations, buddy. Congratulations. Bring your family. They want to get you. All right, Jack, I'm going to get you out there. All right, next up, come on in, Cole. Next, we have a young man by the name of Cole. And Cole, you know, we sent out last week, Pastor Tony and I sent out an email that you probably all saw that it says we're going to be doing baptisms today. Because why, we don't normally have baptisms every once in a while. But he said we're going to do a baptism today. And this young man right here, Cole, he emailed me and he said, hey, you know what? I used to go to Simi Community. I was in the youth group for about a year with Kevin. So Kevin's way out there, he's got that hat on. I don't know if you remember, Cole, but he was there for a little while, right? And he said, I went to Simi Community. I've gone to a couple other churches now, but the Lord has really been placing in my heart that I should be baptized. And then he got this email saying that we're doing baptism. So he says, well, why don't I come back to Simi Community and do it right here today? All right, Cole, yeah. All right, Cole, so I have those questions for you as well. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died and rose for the forgiveness of your sins?
I do.
And have you committed to following him, walking in his ways the rest of your life?
Yeah.
All right. Forward. All right, Cole, based on your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, congratulations, Cole. Next, we have Lance. Come on in, Lance. Lance is a friend of Cole's. So Lance has not been here before. You've been to some other churches around Simi Valley, right? And he said also the same thing, that I have been wanting to get baptized. Is this correct? You've been saying that you've been feeling the Lord drawing you to be baptized, to proclaim your faith in him. Excuse me. And when he found out that his friend Cole was coming back to see me to do it, he said, well, can I do it here too? And so he came up today and I asked him, talk to him a little bit. He expressed his faith and I said, yeah, let's do it right here. So you're going to be baptized today as well. All right, Lance, I have those same questions for you. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died and rose for the forgiveness of your sins?
Yes.
Excellent. Have you committed your life to him, walking in his way to say he's going to be the Lord of your life?
Yes.
All right, wonderful. All right, Lance, based on your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Congratulations and welcome to Simi. Well, this has been an amazingly wonderful day in Jesus Christ, has it not? Thank you so much for filling the house today, for being here to proclaim who Jesus is, to answer the question, as these young men did, that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Put your faith into him and have eternal life. Let me pray for us. Father God, thank you for today. Thank you for this amazing time that we had in you. Thank you for each and every young person that was here that is living their life for you. I pray that you would bless them, cover them as they grow, as they go about back to school, in their careers, in the future. We thank you so much. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.